Good morning, everybody. Hi. So today's watercolor work. Today is actually day three in the Modern Calligraphy Summit, which means it's my day. My flourishing video launches today through the Modern Calligraphy Summit, which I'm a little nervous about. I woke up this morning with a pinched nerve in my foot. So I have a massive shooting, stabbing pain every time I step on my left foot. But I put lipstick on, so it'll be fine. Plus, I'm actually wearing shoes today. I usually just go barefoot. So we're gonna start some watercolor work today. I have decided to revisit this fuchsia incident that happened last week. If you guys were watching, it was not pretty. It was a little bit disastrous. So I'm gonna do another fuchsia video today and challenge myself a little bit. So we'll see how it turns out. Hopefully it turns out better than last time. Right, so let me get you guys set up, which I have now lost my tripod. Oh, there it is. All right. So I'm gonna get you set up so you guys can watch me paint. Let me turn you around so you can see what we're... So I've got my palette. I do have a little bit of water in here already, because I did a color study first thing this morning. And a color study, meaning last time I was working with fuchsia, it bled more than I anticipated it bleeding. So I wanted to look at it again, revisit it a little bit, so I could see just how much it was gonna bleed. So here was my first color study. This one, and this one were not supposed to be pink. Those were supposed to be blue and green, so that was a fail. Try number two, that one was a little bit better. So I play around with the color theory first, so that when I actually go to work in the watercolor, I have a little bit better idea of how it's gonna behave and how it's gonna run. And it's a good thing I did, because otherwise I would have had a second fuchsia disaster. So I'm working on a bigger piece of paper today. Trying to figure out the best. So I'm gonna start out with kind of doing a rough sketch of where I'm gonna be placing things, just so I'm not going at it blindly. Okay, so I've put a few circles on my page with their center, so I can tell where my centers are gonna be, what direction I'm gonna be facing. Oops, there you go. And I will erase that when I'm finished. Any questions so far? I guess I'm looking at the camera. Good, good, okay. So I'm gonna start out with my fuchsias. Blasted with ruddy pinks. Oh, anybody who's watching my video today, I used the word ruddy in my handout. I amused myself. It is a very gloomy day outside. It's raining, which I love. So this is actually doing something kind of funny. All right, let me ask you guys a question. Do you prefer the higher view up here or a lower view down here that I would just kind of move around as I went, but you can see a little bit further up close? What do you guys prefer? Anybody? Anybody want to weigh in on this? Do we prefer down low or up high? No one? Not so cool. I'm also struggling a little bit with light today because it's cloudy outside. But my lamp is making some shadows on here. What's happening? Oh, that's why my chat is hidden. Hold on, let me figure this out. Like, you guys are ignoring me. It's not nice. There we go. This one, is this view better? Sorry, I accidentally ignored you. My bad. Alright, I'll just move you guys around. Oh good, it's so nice to see you back. I was worried. This view will be much more interesting when the paint starts to bleed a little bit through. Yes, I will erase the pencil when I'm finished. It doesn't always come off that well, especially in some of the paler colors. I wrote a little bit darker today than I normally do, because I've noticed in past videos you guys can't actually see it. Well, I used to not be able to paint a flower either, don't feel bad. This is something that I definitely had to learn. There was a learning curve involved. This is a watercolor that's in my palette. This one right here. So I actually have no idea what watercolor this is. I went over the watercolors I used a few days ago. And basically it's, I pick my watercolor for its color and its pigment, like the pigment, the actual pigment content. So I don't always know what brand I'm using, especially because I don't pull it out of the tube every time. I put it in my palette. Makes mixing paint a lot easier. Ah! It's much more pink than I thought it was going to be. Honestly, what brushes do I recommend for beginners? Most of my brushes are probably considered beginner brushes. I don't spend a ton of money on brushes. You can, I mean, don't get me wrong, you can spend massive amounts on brushes. I don't, because I tend to leave mine in my cup and it ruins the tip of them. So I don't spend a lot of money on brushes. I have some really good ones, but it's not usually what I use. I use the ones that you can pick up at an art store. Okay, so I'm mixing color right now. The green I had in my color test earlier was a little bit yellower than I had wanted. I did not finish the painting for my mom, but I did work on it a little bit more yesterday. And I'll pull it up in a few days and we'll work on it some more. I'm gonna go grab that piece of paper I did my color study on. We'll use the ugly one. I want it a little bit yellower. I want some more yellow here. It's a little bit better. And then I am going to make this yellow pile.
a little bit more yellow. And I'm going to add a little bit of green to it. So I've got a green that is yellowish and a yellow that is greenish.
Yep, all right, that's more yellow. Okay, I don't know if anybody has ever used a Lucite chair. I have a really pretty chair. Here, let me show you. This is my chair. It's gorgeous. I love it. Except that when I slide in and out of it, like when I scooch it forward, I very often slide off my chair, and I definitely almost just fell on the floor. Oh. If for some reason Ashley Wren is watching this, she has witnessed this, where I've actually very close to fallen out of my chair. So she gets back down. Okay, so I'm pretty aware of where I'm gonna place my leaves. Because this pink bleeds so badly, I also let it dry just a little bit. But I want it to bleed a little bit. Okay, I found this chair at Marshall's, guys. It was like $40. Okay, so I'm very careful with my placement, but I do want to catch that pink a little bit. If I didn't catch it on that side was a little dry, so we'll try over here. There we go. Okay, and it didn't catch as much as I wanted it to, so I'm gonna take a little bit of the pink from my palette and drop it right on top. There we go. Someone had asked me yesterday, I think on Instagram, about a piece I had done for a watercolor workshop for the Oh So Inspired retreat that was back in November that was all in blue. But if I was gonna do any more of those. So I do monochromatic fairly often. Oh, yep, just put my hand in that. I do monochromatic fairly often because monochromatic and paying attention to how monochromes work together is a really good way of learning about depth. Like we talked about yesterday in atmospheric perspective, you learn that doing monochromatic as well. So for example, these leaves, I've got the lighter leaves and it gets darker towards the inside. The lighter leaves are going to be further back, further away from the viewer, and the darker leaves are going to be closer to the viewer. So when working with monochromatic, we'll look at that a little bit more in depth and do a little bit of a depth color study as well that I always think turn out really pretty. Oh, look at that bleed. That was pretty. The other thing when I am working with bleeds that I actually do want the bleeds, I very often will mix a little bit of this green with the pink in my palette. So I've got like a medium color. So I'm gonna do it right here. Just pull some of this green and throw it right here. So then this color, this would be my medium. And it could be a little bit darker. So just fix this up. Adding some water to these because I didn't wet them this morning. I didn't think I was going to be using them, but as it turns out, I am. And then I'm going to add a little bit of yellow. Ooh, that was a lot of yellow. So when you mess up, you do this. This is a roll of toilet paper. That's walnut ink from yesterday. That's walnut ink. Did not like that color. Let's try again. I usually allow this to happen a little bit more naturally, but I'm forcing it today, so it's gonna take a little bit more effort. There we go. Okay, let's try that medium color. Okay, yep, that'll work. That'll give me a little bit more depth to my leaves as well. So I'll add a few of these guys. Okay, so now because I have these light leaves here, this is my background, I can add another leaf on top of it, and that would be in the foreground. I'll do it over here too.
So these other leaves are a little wet still, so it's not gonna stand out. And I just dropped my brush. It's not gonna stand out against them quite as much because they bled a little bit, but I like that. So that gives me some depth in leaves. I've got these guys in the background, these guys in the foreground. And then this is kind of a browny pink that is a medium color between the leaves and the flower. And I almost always use an angled brush for my leaves. They're just so much easier. Yeah, this flat brush is awesome. This is one I picked up at Michael's. This is the only brush I will actually spend money on. I have a really nice one, but it's so nice that I don't usually use it. Because I'm scared that I'll ruin it. Okay, so because this flower was already fairly dry, I'm going to add a little bit of this pink in here. Oops, wrong pink. I used the rose matter for that one, so it's a little bit duller of a pink that I can actually handle. Ugh, pink. Where did I learn? Anybody who's on the Modern Calligraphy Summit, our private group board, I'm autodidactic, I am an autodidact. Meaning, I am basically self-taught. I did go to school for art. I did interior design, so I did have some art in there, but most of this stuff is just self-taught, and I just did exactly what I told people yesterday not to do. When you put just in a sentence, it diminishes whatever follows. So if you say, oh, I just wanted to reach out, it's kind of doing it a little sheepishly, and I really try and stay away from that as much as possible. I know my girlfriend Ashley was just saying she uses the Gmail platform for all of her work stuff, and she was just saying she found a plugin that highlights it when you write words like just or something that's diminishing in an email to a client so that you can learn to stop doing that. So when people ask if you are self-taught or did you go to school for this, I always say, oh, I'm an autodidact, which means self-taught. It's just a very fancy word for it. But I never want to diminish the fact that I'm self-taught. And it took years to be able to do that. I am self-taught in flourishing as well, yes. And we'll talk a little bit more about how I learned how to flourish in this afternoon's video at noon, where I'm going to talk about flourishing. So learn that word, autodidactic or an autodidact. It's a great word. Also, someone's like, oh, did you go to school for this? They don't actually mean it as an insult, but it does come across as like, oh, well, you didn't go to school for this, so you're not legit. And I think it's more that we as artists take it like that, more than people actually mean it like that. But then when you say, oh, I'm an autodidact, they don't actually know what that means. It just makes you sound really smart. I did not wet the paper first. I didn't want it bleeding quite that much. And thank you. Someone just a second ago asked me how I got into this. So my progression in my business of wetting stationery is actually kind of a long story. I should probably do that at a different time because it really is, it's a long story. But basically I tripped, stumbled, fell, and landed on it. Which happens. I feel like as artists, that's part of figuring out what our goals are and who we are as people, is learning to not ignore when chance slaps us in the face, which is hard to do. It's actually one of my favorite things. I absolutely love seeing how an idea or a project grows and evolves over time. But if we're not watching for that, we often miss it. Because we'll say something like, oh, well, my goal is to X, Y, and Z. Well, if your goal is to X, Y, and Z, and you don't watch out for L, M, and N, sometimes you miss it, and that's actually what you were supposed to be doing. Exactly. So you do have to kind of take a chance sometimes. But you also have to be open-minded about your definition of who you are as a person and who you are as an artist and as a professional. Because if you say, I'm a wedding stationery designer, and you know, when I had a client come to me a few years ago who wanted baby shower invitations for a book themed baby shower, which PS, I need to put on my website again because they were so freaking cute. And you don't think, I mean, my mind kind of went, well, I don't have good graphics for this. I don't really know what I'm doing. I'll just do something basic. I said, you know, I haven't done illustration in a while. I kind of want to play around with that. And that first invitation was the first one I did that was artwork based and lettering based. And it opened a whole new world for me. And I had a business partner at the time. I talk about her occasionally, Jenny from Graceline Art. And we kind of both sat down, and honestly, it was Jenny that pushed me. And we kind of sat down and we said, well, wait, why can't we do artwork based invitations? Why do we always have to have graphic based anything? We can do whatever we want, it's our business. So that's what we did. And so they say, the rest is history. It's a longer story than that, and I'll get into it at some point. Because it's a story that I actually really love. How did I come up with my name, Moira? Okay, this is a question I actually get asked, I think, more than anything else. So I'd love to tell you about it. And my YouTube account name is the same account, or same name, same handle, as my Instagram, and my Periscope is Design House with Moira. I'm gonna flip this around. This is a big paper. This is taking up a lot of space on my desk this morning. Okay, Moira is from Wendy Moira Angela Darling. Anybody know what that's from? Any takers? Wendy Moira Angela Darling. Yep, there you go, Peter Pan. Because I never want to grow up. Because when I went to name my business, I knew I didn't want to pigeonhole myself. I knew that I loved the evolution of a creative business. And I knew that I never wanted my team to be limited to just me and just what I did. So for example, when Jenny and I were business partners, it wasn't, video telling your story. Yeah, I will at some point. That'll probably be on YouTube. When Jenny and I were business partners, I never wanted it to be Jenny Sanders for Victoria Rothwell Design. I wanted her to be able to stand on her own feet as an artist and as a business partner. Oh, my dog just joined us. Wanna say hi to Monday?
Hi, sweetheart. Hi. Can you look at me? What is it? What do you want?
I know you wanna go outside. You wanna go on a walk? Do you? Oh, she's gonna bark at me now. Can you speak? Oh, honey bunny. Hi, sweet girl. She's my big girl.
Hi, honey bunny.
Yep. She just comes in to steal things out of my trash can. she's so cute. Okay, so back to Moira. So, I knew I wanted my business to be bigger than myself. I knew that if I ever had other people, or when I had other people working for me, she's a she. Oh, wait, no, your dog. Just kidding. That's a walk word. That's adorable. Yeah, she throws fits. I mean, as Newfies throw fits, and not really fits, because they're like the laziest dogs ever. She wants to go on a walk midday, and yesterday she was so insistent, she went down and sat by the front door and just cried. She wants to go out and chase the squirrels. She can't chase squirrels. She's not fast enough. She thinks she can, though. Okay, back to Moira. So I knew I wanted a business name that would grow with my company and grow with what it was that I decided to pursue, because I knew even in the very beginning that I never wanted to say, this is what I am and this is only what I am. I didn't really know. There was so much I didn't know. I didn't know what I didn't know, and I knew that. So I decided to name my business something a little bit more vague and ambiguous so that I could use taglines or subcategory business names to define who I was as a company and as an artist. So I actually started in event design. I have Moira Events. Moira Events and Design, based in San Diego. And this was 2008. The market then subsequently plummeted, and as a very new business owner. I'd come out of the events world. I wasn't a bride that was like, I really want to do this because I'm just planning my wedding. Not that that doesn't have some amount of legitimacy. No, I just can't take them seriously. I'm sorry. I was working at Weston as a social catering manager for their Weston San Diego location. And when the market crashed, hotels got hit really hard. So I was let go. My assistant took my job at $20,000 lower salary. It was really bad. And I ended up sitting around looking around in the industry and realizing that no one was hiring. And it was gonna be a while before anybody did. Oh, I missed it. Sorry if you asked a question, I was mixing ink. So I kind of looked around. I knew no one was hiring. I said, well, if you want it done right, you do it yourself. So I started my own business. It was definitely rough going the first few years because the market was so bad. But the other part of the market that was really lacking was graphic design. It was a part of the industry that you could get to if you could pay for letterpress, but there wasn't a happy medium. Wedding Papers Divas didn't exist yet, Minted didn't exist yet. So there was this kind of gaping hole in the industry and I decided to fill it. I wanted to do graphic design for people who appreciated good design but couldn't necessarily afford it. Oops, see, I wasn't paying attention. And this is where my flower is supposed to be and I just put a leaf on it. Oh well, I'll smooth it over a little bit. So I wanted to be able to offer good design to people at a very affordable price. And I learned a few very, very valuable things. One, the lower the budget, the more demanding the client. I offered DIY printable designs. I did super low cost imitations that were all pre-designed, and it was the hugest pain in the butt. They were super demanding. You basically had to handhold the entire time. They weren't really capable of DIY. And this was kind of the beginning of the DIY upswing. It was just bad. And I ended up working crazy, crazy hours and not making any money. And, you know, would it be nice if I just had to do this as a hobby? Sure, but I also need to do it as a living. So I got a job at a restaurant to kind of make ends meet for a while. I worked there for a few years, finally quit. So at that point I had Moira Events and I had Moira Design Studio. Then it moved into Moira Ink, which is calligraphy, where I started learning calligraphy. And the reason we had separated all the business names is because we were running into a problem where graphic designers, like, hey, I want you to work with my client, I want you to do their calligraphy, but they weren't really that fond of the idea that I had imitations on my website. So I started two different websites, one for calligraphy and one for graphics, because I was stepping on people's toes in the industry, and obviously that's kind of not what you want to do. Except that I realized I was just in a bad part of the industry, that the industry shouldn't be like that. And when I moved out to Philadelphia, I had Design House of Moira, Moira Events, Moira Design Studio, Moira Inc. And it was a lot to maintain. I was maintaining all these websites, and I didn't really want it to be like that. I wanted an industry that was a little bit more encouraging and a little bit more supportive of owning multiple businesses and having multiple business ventures. So I combined them all again into Design House of Moira. I basically stopped doing events. I'll do them on a referral from somebody else, but generally speaking, I leave that to people who love doing it, and I just don't. I love doing the design of it, but I don't like the manual labor. It's exhausting. So that's how Design House of Moira came about. It was kind of the catch-all name that I needed to say that, yes, these are all my companies, and yes, they are all related, but yes, I have to separate them because people are mean. So that's what happened. Let's see. This is what we have so far. Yep. So I'm a big fan of the idea that the rising tide floats all boats, and by being an open and transparent member of the community and of the art world, it's a good thing. It's advantageous to me, it's advantageous to others. because when I can come along and say, hey, you know, as an artist, you need to be charging more money because you're not making any, it helps everybody. Okay, so now I'm kind of adding in a little bit of like a bluish green just to give up some depth and a different type of leaf formation. You're very welcome. It was a little bit of a rough beginning there for a while, but you know, eventually I figured it out. Trial and error. Also, I didn't really have anybody else to talk to when I first started. I didn't know any other business owners at all. None of my friends own their own business. There wasn't much of a platform for learning or for growing, and I didn't really have a whole lot of kind of emotional support when it came to like the everyday struggle of, you know, this client or that client, or this person's upset about this, or I feel like I let this person down. Like, there's a lot of emotional turmoil that goes along with not only owning a business, but being an artist. And I remember at one point, the guy I was with, who I'm no longer with, used it as at a dinner party. I remember, I will never forget him saying this, that I don't even remember what I had done. He was like, oh, don't worry. You know, don't worry about her. She's an artist. And it wasn't a compliment. And that was kind of when I was like, okay, let's redefine what an artist is, because that was not cool. Okay, so here's where we are now. Definitely liking this better than last week's fuchsia so far. I feel like I could use a little bit more of a punch of color. I'm going to throw in some, a little bit more yellow. Okay, so we're going to throw in some yellow here, some like chartreuse-y. Gonna do a color test here. That's great. So I'm gonna get this guy, that one. It's really hard to do this while I'm going to have to call you back. It was a PA number though, so they're local. Okay, so I've got some yellow on here. Exactly, being self-taught means I have my own style. I mean, theoretically. That definitely doesn't always hold true, unfortunately, because people who are self-taught, you have two different types of artists. You have artists who can just come up with brilliance without a nudge from an outside party. Most people can't. So you have to be inspired by somewhere. And it's kind of the idea that there's nothing new on the face of the planet. So your inspiration is going to come from somewhere, but you do have to be careful that it doesn't come from someone where it's like, oh, you clearly follow so-and-so because your lettering is exactly the same or your artwork is exactly the same. Like, I can definitely see the influence of like Julie Song in my work. I love, love, love her work. And she was one of the first watercolor artists in the wedding industry that I really took note of, and I really enjoyed her work. And I think you can probably see her her influence in my work. And yeah, it is, it's very tricky as a beginner to find that fine line. And if you watched Fozzie's video yesterday, she does talk about it. My video yesterday did too, if you guys want to catch that. Do catch it though, because it didn't record properly in my phone, so I will not be able to upload it. I'll probably go over it again at some point in the future, but not anytime soon. Kind of developing your own style and pulling from different places in your own life to determine what your style is. And you're right. Your own style will really evolve over time. Whoop! Sorry, I just knocked you over. Mine certainly did. My style did not just come out of thin air. It came with working with clients and deciding what style I liked and what style I didn't like. That's almost just as important as knowing what your style is, as knowing what your style isn't. And when to say no to the clients who aren't your aesthetic. That is really important and something that gets overlooked a lot. Sorry, I knocked my tripod and now it's falling over. All right, so let's spin this page around. I got asked about eraser lines again. I'll erase them when I'm finished, when everything's dry. They come off for the most part. Every once in a while I have one that's stubborn and doesn't want to come off. So in talking about that depth and that perspective again, so I've got a dark one right here in the middle and then I'm going light from there on out. Like I dip my brush once and then I just add water to it to get it to kind of fade. I don't think so. I'm getting hearts. Okay, don't heart your own video. Gotcha. That was dumb. That was not a very nice angle of myself. But my lipstick looks great. Well, I'm seeing a ton of hearts, so if you're like banging away at it, I think I can see it. Okay, let's see. These flowers actually don't have as much depth as I would like. I'm gonna probably go back through and add some more fuchsia to the middle. Oops, sorry, I can't see. So this type of flower formation, I suppose it's kind of a delphinium-ish, if we want to put look what I just did to my yellow, boo. What happens? Let's throw some more yellow in here. Adding some water, dilute that yellow a bit. Let's put my green back in. Just the color out. There we go. Well, these are much better colors than last week's fuchsia, which, I mean, essentially I'm using all the same colors. I'm just diluted them differently, mixed them a little bit differently. I think last week I got flustered by the I asked for everyone's input with the color, and I think I got overwhelmed. I pick based on color I want. Steph just asked what brand of watercolor I use. I pick them based on the color I'm looking for, and honestly what the supply is at the local store. And like for Christmas from my mom, actually both my moms, they asked me what I wanted. I said, watercolor supplies. I said, just go to the store and pick the colors you like, and I will use those. So my Rose Matter, this color, this one was from my mom. Yes, Taylor, I've been, is it Taylor or Taya, sorry. I've been adding the ones that actually do record in my phone onto YouTube. Yesterday's did not, unfortunately. But my YouTube channel is Design House of Moira, just like my handle here. Okay, so here's where we're at. I still think it's missing something. I think something small scale. Yes, I'm missing small scale. So I'm gonna add in some darker color. I'm gonna use my little guy. And I'm gonna take this
color here, and I'm gonna saturate it a little bit more. All right, so I'm gonna throw in some little guys. Now, unfortunately, though, my pink is all dry, so my pink's not gonna continue bleeding into there. But if I get that color next to the yellow, I will get some nice bleeds. So we'll do that over here. I'll adjust this so you guys actually really see this. This is my favorite part. Same thing with that depth of color. I'm going to start out with the darker and add some of those lighter shades in so we've got some variety. Now, if you guys can hear the rain against my window, it's pretty. Add some water to get that dilute a little bit down. Yes, so these are my flat brushes. There's the size and whatever the other one is. This size. I have one that's a little bit bigger as well. See, this is why you don't leave your brushes in your cup. So it curls in your room. That one straightens out though, so it's fine. And technically, if you guys are buying brushes, this is not a flat brush, this is an angled brush. I've tried doing this with a flat brush, it doesn't work quite as well. Close enough. So that one has some good depth. Actually make this one a bit darker. With angled brushes though is I really do have to be at the right angle to do them. It's hard to do them sideways or upside down. Okay, that helps. So the reason I wanted to add some little leaves is because my scale was a little bit funny. I have big flowers, big leaves, but I didn't have anything small. So to balance out that scale a little bit, I did the smaller leaves. So I'm gonna go in and add some darker fuchsia in here. Ugh, just put my hand on that yellow again. The other thing I can do is add maybe some yellow into the middle of these flowers, which I will probably do in a second. Let's see if that works. Bye, Amy. See you later. Try adding in some yellow, and hopefully it doesn't look terrible. I'm just kind of letting it bleed. I have a lot of water on my brush right now, so it's kind of just gooping on there. Ooh,
that might look really bad when it dries. We'll see. I guess this yellow does have a little bit of green to it right now too, from how I mixed it. Grab some of this just straight now. And I'm not adding yellow all the way through, I'm kind of keeping it to one side. This is a problem. Whoops! So I'm just watching the video and not the page. There you go, that's fine. Okay, so I think this is done.
Here's our finished piece.
Alright, so I will wait for this to dry, guys, and then I will... You want to take a picture? Here, hold on. There we go. I kind of think this is upside down, though. Turn around. Yeah, I feel like that's right side up. The other one was upside down to me. Anybody else want to take a picture? I think I might have a new phone background. Ooh, I could totally do that. Maybe I should make this into a phone background. Thank you. Alright guys, so that's it for this morning's painting. I will post a picture on Instagram later on. It would make a pretty placemat. It would also make really good fabric. So thanks for joining me this morning for a painting and a little bit about how I started my business and where my business name comes from. It's from Peter Pan. I'm sure we'll get that question again, so I'll go into it in some pretty good detail at some point. It's a story I really love to tell, so I like to be able to give it a little bit more attention. So I will see you guys at noon when we do some flourishing work. I'm not looking forward to doing flourishing on the video. It makes me very nervous. So we'll see how it goes. If you guys are part of the Modern Calligraphy Summit, make sure you tag me in your work on Instagram. I want to see it. I want to see you guys' progress. And if you have questions for me about flourishing, hit me up on our Facebook page if you're a member of the summit, so I can answer them directly there. But I will see you guys later today, and have a good morning. Bye.